family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. You can be better informed, more motivated, and more effective. Subscribe to our fact-filled newsletter, follow us on Facebook, check out our YouTube channel, listen to our podcasts, and keep up to date with all of our projects at ruthinstitute.org. Maria Keffler of Partners for Ethical Care was one of our speakers at this year's summit. She is Kathleen Benfield's guest on her radio show, The Current Word, where they're discussing her new book, Desist, Detrans, and Detox, Getting Your Child Out of the Gender Cult, about pressures on children to participate in the transgender lifestyle.
At the end, I was talking to you about the issue of how even medical schools now are completely doing away with real, true language that deals with human sexuality, abandoning the terms male and female, and treating biological sex as just a social construct. There's no real objective truth as to whether or not a person is a male or a female. And this is coming down now from the highest levels. It comes from the federal government, from state government, from science, from medicine, from every discipline. We are seeing the total obliteration of objective truth with respect to human sexuality. So at this conference that I went to recently, I met a woman there who has written a book about the whole issue of gender identity and children and young people and how families and parents can deal with that. So what we're going to do now is bring on my guest. Her name is Maria Keffler, and she's going to share with us about her new book and also how we can navigate this topic as a society and as a family. I met Maria recently at a conference of the Ruth Institute in Lake Charles, Louisiana, not far from here, and I was just so intrigued by the organization that she is with, as well as a new book that she has that is aimed at helping parents and others to navigate the landscape of this whole transgender culture and gender identity issues. Maria is with a group called Partners for Ethical Care, and about a month ago, we talked with her partner, Aaron Brewer, who did struggle with issues related to gender dysphoria and, thank God, had resolved those and is now working to help others in the same way that Maria is. Maria, good afternoon, and welcome to New Orleans, and welcome to The Current Word.
Thank you, Kathleen. I appreciate you inviting me onto your show, and I really enjoyed visiting with you, getting to meet you at the conference in Louisiana.
That was an awesome conference, right? I mean, I'm going to be introducing our listeners to other topics and speakers that were at the conference, but I can't remember a conference that I have attended in the past in which the speakers were just one after another, so dynamic and so informative on these different topics. How about you?
Oh, it was such a powerful conference. And yeah, just one after another after another. I'll be honest, I went to the conference feeling maybe a little bit arrogant, like, yeah, I know this stuff, I'm good, but I learned so much, met people who provided perspectives on things I hadn't even thought about. So it was a fantastic conference.
It was, and I will be slowly but surely introducing our listeners to some of the other speakers. But I was intrigued by you and your topics, and you have recently written a book called Desist, Detrans, and Detox, Getting Your Child Out of the Gender Cult. And so we're going to be discussing this book and some of the concepts that are in it. I want to immediately get into what those terms mean in just a second, but can you just explain to us what was the motivation for you to write this book? What sort of compelled you to put out a pretty thick book and very, very informative on this whole topic? This is something that you've worked with children and worked as an advocate for children, I know, for many years, but this is a very interesting topic. Go ahead, Maria.
Well, I'm a teacher, and my kids were in the public school system until just a couple of years ago when we pulled to homeschool. And I got involved with this issue first when a friend discovered that our school district here in Arlington, Virginia, was pushing through some policies around transgender identified students. They were doing it pretty quietly. My friend came upon it when she was looking for summer school information and saw this working group meeting and asked me to go, and we went, and we were pretty horrified by what we heard. A lot of people sitting around a table in a working group talking about what they wanted with these policies. And the big takeaway from that evening for us was that parents were considered an adversary, that parents were considered dangerous and toxic, and that the school needed to educate parents and protect transgender identified kids from parents who didn't agree with this policy. And I've talked to so many families whose kids, out of the blue, announce a transgender identity. Hey, I've been a girl all my life, but I've discovered I've actually been a boy all this time. I've just been hiding it. Or, you know, a boy announcing that he's a girl or non-binary or whatever. And when the parents talk to the so-called experts, they talk to the teachers, the school counselor, the principal, the pediatrician, the counselor, therapist, they get told by and large, oh, best practices is affirm it. You have to affirm this or the child's going to commit suicide. And that's just emotional blackmail. That's mm-hmm. that's an abuse tactic that abusers use, saying, you know, give me everything I want or I'm going to commit suicide. And coming from my background of education, I have a degree in educational psychology. This didn't make sense to me. These policies that the schools were pushing through don't make sense to me. And as I started investigating transgender ideology, the whole thing doesn't make sense to me. So I wrote this book to try to help parents who don't buy that line, that party line, that, oh, you have to affirm this, there's no other option. Because as my friend Erin Brewer, who you mentioned earlier, she and I have a podcast that we do, a video series that we do called Common Sense Care. And we point out in there every time that in no other area, education, medicine, or psychology, is one treatment plan the best thing for every person. But that's what families are told when their children announce a transgender identity. There's only one path, and it's medicalization. And we don't buy that. I don't buy that. And we put this book out. Partners for Ethical Care published this book in order to help parents find a saner, safer path to get their kids out of what I have come to believe 100% is a cult.
Wow. That was a great intro to this conversation. And I understand what you're saying. You know, one thing we learned recently is that this has become more or less a social phenomenon in the sense that there is a huge upswing in the number of young people who are self-identifying or as struggling with their sexual identity. And some believe that this is just, you know, sweeping our young people because of things on social media or even in the schools, that they're learning that, you know, well, maybe if you're what we used to call a tomboy, well, maybe you think you should be a boy. Maybe you should be a boy. That's pretty much the way it goes, huh?
Yeah, we've been fighting these regressive sexual stereotypes for a couple hundred years or more. You know, it used to be, oh, if you're a girl, you wear pink and you like playing with dolls. And if you're a boy, you know, you play football. Well, we've been fighting these stereotypes and saying, no, there are boys who like to paint. There are boys who like to dance ballet. My cousin is a man. He's a heterosexual man. He's married to a woman. He is a very talented and accomplished ballet dancer. But he, all the time, people assume he must be gay because he dances ballet. Some girls like sports. Some girls don't like to wear dresses, but all of a sudden, this gender ideology is now telling people, oh, if you don't perfectly fit these gender stereotypes, then you're actually not the sex you were born. Yeah, that's and that's crazy. Just ridiculous.
Yeah, and then the other thing that you talked about is that anything short of affirmation is considered abusive and we know, we've talked on this show, oh, so many different times about professionals. It is almost now professional suicide for a person in the mental health fields or in pediatrics and in other areas, endocrinology for youth, pediatric endocrinology. If you don't affirm the path of hormone puberty blockers, hormones, and then bodily mutilation, you then are, you know, drummed out of your profession, basically. Is that something you've seen, or?
Oh, yeah. Over 20 states currently have what are called conversion therapy bans. Now, conversion therapy used to refer to really harmful, abusive things that were done to try to change someone's sexual orientation. If someone said they were gay or lesbian, there were these really abusive things. Reparative rape was one of them. Pairing things like your hand being plunged in icy cold water, with images of homosexual acts. I mean, these were really horrific things. That's what conversion therapy is and used to be. But the gender lobby, the gender industry, has conflated that term, conversion therapy, with what is just healthy, helpful therapies, like watchful waiting, where you just try to see if the child grows out of it. Or talk therapy, where you try to get to the bottom of why does the child feel this way? Well, these so-called conversion therapy bans have been enacted in more and more states, and you're right. Counselors, therapists, mental health care workers can't even ask, why do you think you're transgender, without risking their licensure. Right. It's horrible, and this is another reason why we put out this book. Because so many parents can't get ethical, trustworthy counseling and therapy help for their kids. It's very hard to find counselors and therapists who will give the good, appropriate, ethical therapy because it's being outlawed.
All right, let's get into your book now. And the title of your book is Desist, Detrans, and Detox, Getting Your Child Out of the Gender Cult. So perhaps an appropriate path forward would be for us to define what each of those terms mean, and then we'll get into some of the specifics of the book. So let's start with desist. What does that mean in the context of your book?
Okay, desist is to stop insisting that you are transgender. When a child or any person desists, we say that they're desisting from saying that they're transgender. They no longer believe that they are the wrong sex. They have desisted from that belief.
Yeah. Okay. So, and like in the case of Erin Brewer, that, like I say, we talked with her a few weeks ago. She was insisting that she was a boy. She wanted to be a boy because of incidents related to sexual assault, etc. Mm-hmm. And but she received counseling, and eventually she stopped saying that she was a boy, and she realized, no, I'm a female, and that is what I am, and I'm going to pursue being a female. So I guess that's pretty much what you mean by desisting, to stop insisting that you are something that you're not.
Exactly. It's to accept your birth sex as reality and believe that you really are what your body says you are.
Okay, great. Okay, and then detrans, I think I know what that means, but you can go ahead and articulate that for us.
Yeah, it's short for detransition. When someone transitions, that's when they begin to say that they are the opposite sex. If a girl transitions to presenting as a boy, then she's changing her hair, her clothes. She may go the medicalization path. She's trying to impersonate a boy, and that's called transitioning. Well, someone who detransitions, similar to desisting, stops trying to present as the opposite sex or as a different, trying to look differently than they actually mm-hmm. are. And so we say they've detransitioned or they're a detrans.
So this can go anywhere from just stop saying that you're a man when you're really a biological female to stopping taking hormones, trying to reverse the effect of previously taken hormones, and in the case of surgery, I guess there may be a few things that they can do, but we've interviewed people on the show who have detransitioned and they are still living to this day with the negative effects of the hormones and of the surgeries that they received, which in many cases sterilizes them, not able to have children, and also, you know, in the case of women, having facial hair, all sorts of things like that. So, okay, so, and then detox would be the last word in your title. What would that mean?
Well, this cult really is toxic. As you described, the puberty blockers, the hormones, the surgeries, they are really toxic to the human body, and in many ways, they are irreversible. As we've seen, women who've been on testosterone for a while, they don't stop, you know, they continue to grow facial hair, their voices don't change. But it's also toxic on a psychological level and on an emotional level and on a relational level. This cult damages everything it touches. And the gender cult tries to pull kids in and separate them from all of their protections, tells them that their parents aren't safe, tells them their parents don't love them. Anybody who doesn't wholeheartedly say, yes, absolutely, let's get you on the path of medicalization, everybody who would protect that child is to be cut off. And so much, I would go so far as to say nearly all that this cult teaches is wrong. It's a lie. It's not true. And they're seeding these really toxic ideas into these kids. And part of what my book is about is helping the child to understand that he or she is loved by the family, and also to help the family start questioning and start sort of providing the child some questions that will help the child start to think again. Because being pulled into a cult, one of the things that happens is you're really taught not to think. So many of these phrases that you hear people parrot, trans women are women, love is love, trans people are here, get over it. These are all thought-stopping slogans. They're given to people so that the recruits don't have to think about the questions that they're asked. Well, why are trans women women? Why is a man who thinks he's a woman actually a woman? Why does he get preferential treatment to go into the bathroom with other women? Why don't women get the right to say no to that? And so helping kids learn to start asking those questions and answering those questions will really help them to start seeing how they've been lied to, how much of this is illogical, how much of it is not true, and to come back to reality, come back to safety, come back to their families, and get out of this cult. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's one thing that we learned is that, I guess it goes kind of two ways. One is that in many cases, the person who is pursuing being not their biological sex, a lot of times, especially in very young children, this is something that is initiated by the parents, that it's something that the parents want. I guess as older children, when you get into the teen years, it seems like it would be more likely that this would be something that they are getting from others around them, which would actually, in most cases, I'm sure, puts them at odds with their parents. I know, you know, movie stars, Hollywood stars are so proud to announce that they are now raising a transgender child. That's sort of like the new craze to have a child that doesn't identify as their biological sex. But would you agree with that, that in younger children, it may be more a case of what the parents are wanting, like the young boy James in Texas, and then in the older years as teens, it's most likely a social issue rather than a parental issue. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think that's a very good point, and I think you're exactly right. When we're seeing it with these young kids, I think there's a couple things that can be happening with young children. Young children, you know, ages 3, 4, 5, you know, even up through 9, they have a very active and vibrant imagination, and they do a lot of imaginary play. Anybody who's been around young child, you know, the child may say, I'm a cowboy, I'm a princess, I'm an astronaut, I'm a unicorn. And they're role playing different people and different animals, and they're experimenting with life. And this is part of childhood. This is a normal, natural part of childhood. I have a friend whose son, when he was three and in preschool, for I want to say it was a couple of months, he wanted to wear the blue princess dress at preschool every day. And the parents were a little freaked out by this. This was probably, gosh, 15 years ago now. But the teachers told his parents, hey, this is just role play. This is what kids do. This means nothing about his future sexuality. You know, just we recommend just letting him do it and he'll probably get bored with it. And that's what happened. After a couple of months, he didn't play that way anymore. I still know this young man. He's a perfectly normal, healthy, red-blooded American male. But today, if that happened, those school teachers would probably say, this is evidence that that child is transgender and needs to be transitioned. You need to buy him dresses, you need to buy her dresses, mm-hmm. let her grow her hair out. So teachers and, you know, educators and healthcare professionals, they've been indoctrinated through their in-services and trainings to watch for just that sort of thing. And then tell the parents that they need to transition their child. And it makes absolutely no sense. But you also touched upon there are parents who love attention. There are some very woke parents who think this is the best thing ever to get their child on TV, on a reality show. There's something called Munchausen's by proxy. And Munchausen's is a syndrome where a person fabricates illnesses in order to get attention from medical personnel. And this is something that we have seen and we're suspecting is happening with very young kids sometimes, is the parents are causing their children to be ill in order to get attention from healthcare professionals. And so I think you're right. That is sometimes what's happening with very young kids.
So this book, who do you feel like is the target audience for your book, Desist, Detrans, and Detox? Who do you think would be the most helped by reading your book?
It's for parents whose children are saying that they are transgender or non-binary, and the parents are skeptical about the party line that they have to affirm this. This is for parents who want another path, who don't want to go the gender clinic path, who are nervous, rightly scared about puberty blockers and cross-sex hormones and surgeries. I would like for every parent whose child announces a transgender identity to get this book before they make any medical or even social decisions about their child, because I lay out in there some of the stuff that we've talked about. Where did this come from? Why is this happening? What are some reasons kids might do this? And what are your options?
Yeah, that sounds great. And I agree with you. I think that it could be helpful. But I also think in a larger sense, like people like myself will be educated about the different ramifications of this whole issue. And we're trying to present a way, and yours is, I know from looking at the book, a loving way to deal with this issue, and not in any way, abusive or demanding, but helping them to work through it in a rational, loving, and caring way, while not affirming what is cannot be, which is that a boy can become a girl and a girl can become a boy. And I really like that. One of the things that you, the title of your book is Getting Your Child Out of the Gender Cult. And the cult is kind of a loaded word. Why did you decide to call it the gender cult? What did you think about that?
Yeah, we did discuss that at PEC quite a bit, whether that was a good word to use or not. It's a powerful word, and it's one that's pretty direct. But as I was investigating this and studying and reading and trying to figure out what's going on with these kids, I started recognizing more and more aspects of cult indoctrination, because there are some very specific things that cults do, whether you're talking about the Moonies or you're talking about, you know, a Jim Jones or a David Koresh sort of situation. Cults have some very specific things they do. And as I was investigating this gender does every single one of them. Mm-hmm. They target vulnerable people. they love bomb them. They say, oh, we love you. You're wonderful. You're one of us. They provide this arcane different lexicon, all
oh
these
my gosh.
New words.
Yes, we've talked about that so much here on the show. Yeah, the language. Yeah,
yeah, and that's definitely an aspect of cult behavior. And the in-group and out-group, if you're one of us, you're the holy, you're the good, you're the right. Everybody who's on the outside is awful and toxic and terrible. And I outline this in the book, that there's a one-to-one correlation between the steps that cults take to recruit and retain their indoctrinees and what gender does. And it's really horrifying when you recognize that that is what's happening. And we believe that is the appropriate word. It is a cult.
Yeah, definitely. And we even played interviews clips from the committee hearing here in Louisiana at our Capitol, in which they were debating the whole issue of women in sports and fairness in women's sports. And it was, I mean, for the average person listening to this, even the legislators were like, wait, what is this cisgender now? And what does that mean? And, you know, it was really bizarre, all the different things that they talked about and the way they expressed themselves. And also, just even on the whole area of the whole issue of homosexuality in general, that a lot of times is very difficult for people to walk away from, because they become surrounded mostly, if not solely, by people who affirm their behavior and live like them. And so walking away is you're basically leaving your entire culture, all those you know. And I've interviewed other people that have detransitioned and had that same experience, where it's, you've got, you know, boyfriends or girlfriends, you know, romantic relationships, you've got friends, and mostly because they've abandoned their traditional family and their biological family because of, you know, and then adapted this whole new culture and family that is affirming of those decisions and encouraging them. So Maria Keffler, thank you so much. We're almost out of time. Maria's book is called Desist, Detrans, and Detox, Getting Your Child Out of the Gender Cult. If you are interested in learning more about this whole issue of transgender, and also about how to encourage and help people who are struggling with this, I think it's a great idea. Maria, would you tell our listeners where they can find out more about your organization? And also, you mentioned this podcast that you do. Could you tell us about that, please? And where they can find your book?
Yes, I'm from Partners for Ethical Care, and you can find out more about us at our website at partnersforethicalcare.com. You can also email us at support@partnersforethicalcare.com. The book is listed on our website, and it's also listed at Amazon. And we would be very happy to answer any questions anyone has about this issue.
All right. Well, Maria Keffler, thank you so much for being with us today. And I know our listeners are going to greatly appreciate all this wisdom that you've given us, and also checking out your book, Desist, Detrans, and Detox. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you, Kathleen.
You've just been listening to Maria Keffler and Kathleen Benfield discussing how to help children get out of the transgender cult. Maria's book is Desist, Detrans, and Detox, Getting Your Child Out of the Gender Cult, and her organization is Partners for Ethical Care. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. Like us on Facebook, check out the site, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.